Our next inductee is Douglas F. Reid. Douglas F. Reid, he was in the alumni class of 1961. I was able to talk to Doug last night. He's a wonderful man, lively man. He graduated from Ball State University, so chirp chirp, with a bachelor's degree in physical education and a minor in business. He was elected to the Ball State Hall of Fame playing on the 1965 undefeated football team. He was a three-sport athlete at Frankfort and was selected All-State in football in 1961, as well as an Indiana All-Star in basketball. I told him last night the Colts could sure use him last year. He ranks fourth on the all-time scoring list in basketball with 1,449 career points. That's a big deal. He's an All-American at Louisberg Junior College in North Carolina. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm welcome to our inductee, Douglas F. Reid.
I'd like to start by thanking the committee and Chris and Don for the invite and a very nice ceremony here. In 1957, I was brought up in South Bend, Indiana, and my father was transferred to Frankfort, Indiana. I was in the eighth grade. At the seventh grade level, I was 6 foot 3 inches tall. Thought I was going to be 7 foot tall. I've never grown an inch, and as a matter of fact, I'm 6 foot one now. But we moved to Frankfort. It was a really wonderful experience for us. My father had worked out of town for like 2 years. And I was the oldest, so I had to be the man of the house. I walked my mother to the drugstore she worked at and walked her back at night after school. And so we moved here, and we had Dad, all of us together, so I was very happy. And at the eighth grade level, had a coach. Dick Pullen was our eighth grade coach. He was like a high school varsity coach. And I got here just in time to play in the eighth grade tournament. We had another fellow on the team, Larry Wheatley. He was 6 foot four. And we had a guard on that particular team, Bob Brandstetter, that had scored 27 points a game. We went to Lebanon, played them on a championship game, and won the game. So on the way home, Coach Pullen stopped by his house, had a big party, and all that. I hadn't experienced a lot of basketball when I moved here. I was more into football and whatnot. So after our game, I experienced some of the seniors, the varsity basketball team playing and the enthusiasm that went on there. I'm sitting in the house on a Saturday about the week after the sectional, and somebody's out in front of the house tooting the horn. Mom says, "Why don't you see what they want?" So I went out there. There's a little guy about that tall, fellow named Larry Good. He said to me, he says, "Doug, you don't know me, but the coach sent me to see you, and if we're going to have a basketball team next year, I have to develop you because you're 6'3", and we don't have many players 6 foot 3 inches tall." So he said, "Get in the car." I said, "Well, I've got to go ask my mom." And from that point on, I got involved in the basketball experience, going to the park, playing against older kids and whatnot. And then as a freshman, they put me on the varsity. And right away, I noticed I was on the second string. And right away, I noticed everybody wanted to guard everybody but this one guy. His name was Larry Mountie. And I guarded Larry. So after about a week, still a second stringer. guarding Larry. So one day I sneak up there real quick and I guard somebody else. And lo and behold, I ended up being on the first string because I wasn't having to be embarrassed by Larry. We had a pretty good basketball team that year. A fair basketball team, we'll put it that way. Our big game in basketball that year was that we played Logan Sport, who was in the top 10 in the state, and we beat them there at Logan Sport. I also played on the varsity as a freshman player, and in order for me to play on the varsity, we had our former quarterback, Harry Grafton. And Harry was probably one of the fastest athletes I ever saw. We ever also had a fullback named Tom Bogus. And Tom was a 240, 250 pound fullback. Our big game of that year was beating Logan Sport. So then we go on to my sophomore year. We had a coach come in, Frank Bykowski. And he was the coach from Elwood. Actually, that was about my junior year. I'll talk about Coach Bykowski. And he was from Purdue, and Elwood had been successful. And we'd get ready to play the games, and you thought Newt Rockne was standing there talking to us. You know, we kind of tried to not get too worried about things, but he was ready to go all the time. We were always in great shape. Mondays we didn't hit. We went and we had to run three quarters of a lap three times in full gear in a certain time in order to have practice over with. So finally, our senior year with Coach Bykowski, I want to say something else. We had an assistant coach named Reese Henniger. Some of you may remember him. When I first got here, I had Mr. Henniger for a science, and usually most of the time you had I'm going to say the football coach we had then was our health teacher, and a lot of times he didn't show up to class. And we had a fellow named Mark Hoffman, and he would stand and take a T-bar and play the guitar on top of his desk. But I noticed about Coach Henniger with science that he was very serious and he was a very good teacher. And he had come from Mississippi, had played football there. So about our senior year, we were playing football under Coach Bykowski, and we did as we usually did. We won our first game, I think it was Central Catholic, and then we played Lafayette Jeff and Logan Sport, and we lost those two games. At that time, Coach Bykowski allowed Coach Henniger to put in what we called a hillbilly offense. It was a single wing, double wing, shotgun. We did things that were different than anybody else did. Now, we were gifted with a lot of ball players that had a lot of courage and worked hard, had good spirit. I remember a player, Joe Dome. He was our center. A lot of you may know him. We were playing, and he got knocked down twice, and he came back to me, and he said, "Doug, I hope you're not mad at me. He knocked me down twice." I said, "That's all we can ask for." So we were getting ready to play that our senior year against Richmond High School. And Richmond High School had been undefeated for 4 years, and they had a line average of 220 pounds. They had their backfield, their running backs run 100, all under 9 flat. I was the biggest guy for Frankfort at 197 pounds, and I ran 110.4, so we were in trouble. They had a fellow, Spencer Givens, I believe his name was, 280 pounds. Kent Ryan, who's sitting here, had to block him that night. Well, Coach Bykowski, I was sitting there with Gary Johnson, Ronnie McClune, who a lot of you may know, what was close to basketball. And you know, we were watching these guys walk by, the door, you know, and whatnot, and we say to each other, "Geez, I hope we don't get hurt for basketball." So anyway, here comes Coach Bykowski, and he's saying, I can feel one tonight, boys, I can feel one. And he says, I know we're going to score first, and I know when we score, it's going to rain, and it's going to thunder. So we went out with our hillbilly offense. A lot of you probably know Ronnie McLuhan from the bank. Ronnie ran the quickest crooked line and so straight ahead line. But he was, we had put together what we called a double reverse. And on that play, a key thing that I had to do was block the end so that when Ron came around, he would be able to be open. Well, Coach Vitkowski told me, he said, Doug, you need to tackle that guy. Nobody be looking and lay on him. So I couldn't block him. I couldn't block my shadow. So I tackled the guy, and here Ronnie came back on the double reverse and went about 50 yards, and we got down close to the goal line and were fortunate enough to score. And that particular night is the only time in my life my father offered me the keys to his car. We beat Richmond 7-0. And believe it or not, when we did score, there were clouds in the sky and it started raining, just like Coach Vitkowski said. My point here is that we were gifted with very good coaching. Then in basketball, I know we're going to talk about Everett Case later on, and his All-American, Sam Ranzino, was our basketball coach. Sam Ranzino was, I played a lot of basketball with different coaches and whatnot, and Sam Ranzino was probably the best coach I ever had. He worked you, I came, basketball came around, I weighed 197 pounds. By Christmas, I was 180 pounds. And when I was a senior, Lafayette Jeff had a string of 16 straight regionals. You know, we had beaten them. They had a coach, Marion Crawley. Marion Crawley was the head of the Officials Association. So every time I played against Lafayette Jeff, Sam Ranzino wanted me to block my man off and keep him from the boards. And every time I did that, I got a foul. For my sporting career, I probably played against Jeff 5 or 6 times, and I always had 4 fouls in the first half. Well, of course, it was the first thing, the same thing happened in the regional. But we ended up playing a double overtime, and we beat Lafayette Jeff that year. And I was very excited about it. Frankfort was very excited. And we also were fortunate. I had a track coach, Dick Ricker. I mention these names because hopefully some of you will remember these people. They might have been relatives and whatnot. Mr. Ricker was our athletic director and also our track coach. And we were lucky enough to beat Lafayette Jeff in track. So we beat Jeff 2 out of the 3 main sports that year. I met the pole vaulter that Frankfort got, vaulting 18 feet. Well, that meet was over. We had won the relay, and we were now tied at the end of the meet, and it was left to the pole vault. And we had a, our pole vaulter, I had brought us a fiberglass pole to pole vault, didn't know how to use it, and I used a Swedish steel pole vault, and I made 12 foot, and that won the track meet. The fellow that's here, he vaults 18 feet. So it was quite a difference. Let's see what else. I apologize. Talk about when I first came here, Howard Hall. We played at Howard Hall. I don't know how many of you were here, but the whole hall was filled with pictures of former athletes that had won state championships. So it was quite an experience. When I went to Ball State, we had an athletic director. His name was Bob Primer. He was from the 1936 with Jay McQuarrie and played on that state championship team. While I was at Ball State, we were fortunate if I ever had, and I got myself in a little bit of trouble every now and then, and of course Mr. Primer, you could always tell that there was a hot dog helping a hot dog. And he would suggest certain things. An example, I played football as my senior year at Ball State, and we were undefeated, and we got invited to a bowl. And Mr. Primer, the basketball coach, was there, and the football coach brought me in, and he wanted me to make a choice. He says, you know, I had a full scholarship in basketball. I didn't have a scholarship in football. And being a fellow hot dog, he said to me, he says, Doug, you have a choice here to either honor our school by going to and playing football, but if you so desire, you can give up on football and you can go to the basketball team. And I knew what he meant, and I said, I'll stick with the football team because of the, you know, the honor that we have at the school. I have a teacher story I'd like to tell you. I played football at IU for a year. Got hurt my knee, and I ended up, Sam Ranzino was a good, I was gonna go play basketball at North Carolina State. And Sam told my dad, he said, Doug, put Doug on a bus, by the time he gets here, we'll get him something. So I got on a bus, and by the time I got there, I got to spend some time with Coach Everett Case. I spent a day with him, and I spent the day at his house. Well, school had already started, and North Carolina State was having some problems. They had some players that were shaving points and whatnot, so they suggested I went to a junior college. So I've mentioned a lot of things about men teachers in my life, and I had to take an English class at Louisberg, and we had a 90-year-old English teacher, and her name was Miss Merritt, and it was a Saturday morning class. And I went up there to the class one Saturday morning, and right before the end of class, Miss Merritt said to me, Douglas, can you stay after? I said, well, yes, I can. I said, oh boy, what did I do now? And so students left, and she closed the door. And she said, Douglas, I want to tell you something. You have a more creative mind on your in-class themes than your girlfriend that's writing your themes that you bring in when I give them as assignments. So she said, how about you and I forming a team? And she says, you use your creative mind. I'll cross the T's, dot the I's, put the commas in, check the spelling, and we'll be a team. And so that was really great. And I went about, I think it was 2 years ago, and I stopped in North Carolina. My coach there was close to death, and I stopped to see him. And we visited with him, and I could tell he was tired. He says, Doug, why don't you go by and see the college? So I said, yeah, I could tell he was tired. So I went over there, and the gym, it's all red brick, beautiful buildings. And I went in the gym that I had lived at, and I saw the athletic director, and I told him about Mrs. Merritt, how that was really neat. Well, I was on my way back to Indiana, and I had a dog, and I took my dog for a walk, and I'm walking, and I'm noticing a huge dormitory, all red brick, five stories. Boy, this wasn't here when I was there. And when I look up and I see the name of the hall, Merritt Hall. And that was, you know, quite devastating to see that. Some of the kids that I played ball with, I'm being honored here today, but a lot of the ball players that I played with, I would think would be deserving of an honor too. When I was in high school, we had Larry Mountie. He went off and played at Utah. Some of you might remember Bill Fugate from down here. He went out and played at Alliant Christian College in North Carolina and held many records. Bill Fugate and I played together, and I don't know, I don't have the records I remember, but at one point I remember that we were the top two scorers on one team. And what I have to say about Bill, I think I averaged 22 and he averaged 17, which was a pretty good scoring amount. But every time that I'd take a shot and miss it, I'd be running down the floor, and Fugate would say, hey, Reid, your arm broke yet? You know. So, but he ended up playing at Atlantic Christian along with Gary Johnson. I don't know if any of you remember, Gary's dad was Splinter Johnson, played on the 1936 state championship team. And we had Ron McMaines played on that team. He was 6'6". He ended up playing basketball at Indiana University. We had another player, Roger Morrison, and he ended up playing at Louisberg where I played, and I had a brother that got a full scholarship to Louisberg Junior College. He just didn't take it. So that's just some things about my experiences at Frankfort. Moved here as an eighth grader. My father was transferred again to Muncie about the time, two or three years after I was out of high school. I can say Frankfort was a real honor for me. And what I liked most, the day Karen and I, our class had us over for lunch. And we were friends. The whole school, it wasn't jealousy and some of the things you see now. We all liked each other. When I was a kid in school, I knew Karen Mandel would be the one that would succeed, and we were happy for each other. So I'm certainly honored to be here. I could tell some more stories, but Ruth Grafton told me she'd give me the signal when I've said enough. So we've had, I am blessed to be here, and Frankfort will always be part of my heart. Thank you very much.